Thank you very much for coming today. So, the world in our grasp, what does it mean? What can people do when there's a major problem and a major environmental crisis? So I'd like to tell you the story of the technology I'm working on and the people I'm working with, and it's called Protei, which is an oil spill cleaning technology. So on the 20th of April 2010, last year, this happened in the Gulf of Mexico. At the time, I was working in Kenya, but I had the luck to be called to help on this. So 11 people died immediately, 16 people were badly injured, 1,000 miles of coast were affected, 60,000 kilometers square of dead zone created, and the worst environmental disaster in the history of this continent that many people don't even think about anymore, but we still have the effect on it. I was working in MIT at the time, then I moved to Boston, from Nairobi to Boston, to develop these cleaning technologies, but we were not really, we were not really influenced to really go and do hands-on work. And the first chance I had, I went in the Gulf of Mexico, and I rented a boat, and you just see this, the hand of a man, but so this is the captain of the boat, and when I arrived in the harbor, first thing that struck me, he didn't have any legs. So this captain lost his legs, so he lost his first leg during the Hurricane Katrina, and he lost his second leg trying to regain his fleet and his men. And so while the BP oil spill was happening, he couldn't do any more fishing work, and the only work that was left for him was cleaning work, basically. And so he took me to the oil spill to see how I was. And the technology they're using to clean up the oil spill is very, very, what's on the surface is very simple. They're using boats like this, and they put oil absorbent to collect 3% only of the oil. If you know the fisherman work already is the most dangerous professional activity. The life expectancy of cleaners statistically diminishes a lot during this kind of environmental cleanup. So for me, it became really clear that we need to develop technologies which are cheaper, faster to implement, and they'll be open source, because many of the technologies are not implemented or have a too high cost because they're patented. And working at MIT, I was in the same problem of developing a technology that would be expensive, patented, and you know, closed source. So I moved to the Gulf of Mexico, and I quit my dream job, and I didn't have any more resource, and so I couldn't go anymore, couldn't rent a boat anymore, so I joined a nonprofit called the Louisiana Bucket Brigade to have access to the oil spill. And so what we did is, at the time, it became forbidden to access the oil spill. Maybe you heard, maybe you remember that time where scientists, independent scientists were not allowed to approach the booms. We couldn't access. So what we were doing was this. We were inflating helium balloons, and I worked on improving this very simple technology, which is a $2 soda bottle, and you put inside a $100 camera inside it, and you fly the bottle above the oil spill, so you're not approaching, you're flying above. So it's completely legal. And so with this very cheap rig, we're taking hundreds or thousands of pictures, and we assemble them on Photoshop, so we work with communities and students, and we assemble an image of a resolution which is 100 times higher than the satellite imageries, and on demand, so the communities can do their own imagery, and they can monitor their own environment. So it's a technology like I was wanting to develop, which is open source, fast to implement, and cheap. And so this is used for the process of environmental justice. So this is how the oil looks from an oil spill looks from space, but this is how it looks if you get a bit closer. And it moves with the wind, the surface currents, and the waves. And so this is how we currently clean up. So we have an oil spill happening terrible, and then we send small boats to basically trace clean line in an ocean of oil. But if we're using the same length of boom, we can actually make a single bar, and if you move up the wind, so if you pay more attention to the natural patterns, you can actually do much better work. If you multiply the rig, you can also even do a better work, but it's very difficult to move something so big against the natural forces. What if we simply use the power of the wind to actually sail up the wind? So we sail slowly, and we intercept the sheen that are moving down the wind. So that's the premises, the idea of Protei. So we just simply try to take a normal sailing boat and pull something long and heavy. But what happens is when you are pulling something long and heavy and you're trying to turn, you lose both the pulling power and the direction. So I need to explain a bit of naval architecture to solve these issues. So you have a hull and you add a sail on top of it. You determine the center of gravity, and right underneath you, this is where you put the centerboard. The centerboard is used to counteract the force of the wind and transform lateral forces in, you know, movement. And you use the rudder as a lever. So what happens is that when the boat is free to move, you can just move a little force and you can control and rotate well. But if you put something long and heavy at the back, it becomes really difficult to turn. So what we thought at the beginning is simply to put the rudder at the front boat, control or absorbent, and here is just a force you can control your object. So this is a test in the leg puncture train, so it's very simple boat, so swimming with the camera in the mouth and the remote control of the head. And so that's the boat, and you see the quality of driving the boat, because in fact it's driving, because you see the rudders at the front, is similar to a car. When you're sailing a boat, you know, sometimes it feels strange because you're sailing like this and then it's the back that moves. But if you're driving a car, it's the front. What if we had like a 4-4 boat? So if you have more than one point of control, but actually 2 points of control, or even 3 or 5, or what if the whole boat actually was the point of control? If the whole boat became the organ of control? So I made this boat which is entirely articulated, so the whole boat changes shape. And so if you're trying to achieve control and everything becomes the instrument of control, then the whole thing becomes more, better. So you displace the center of gravity in the center of flotation towards one another. So it's just like when you're cycling, you're using the centrifugal force to turn, you feel like you're surfing. So it's starting to get really excited about the technology even And so if you look at the sail, you will see the jib and the mainsail, the shift side faster than a normal boat. Why is this? It's because when you're turning, you are exposing the angle of the front of the front sail, the jib, and the mainsail at different angle to the wind. And so you can turn faster, which means that you have constant pulling power. So this is what we're looking for to, you know, pull something long and heavy. But now how can we make this technology better? I was thinking that's a really cool technology, but if we can't make it like a large scale, it's not gonna have any impact on the oarspin. So I thought, well, let's try to build it bigger. So we built this this bigger prototype, which is 3 meter. And it costs less than $100, so it's just plastic and duct tape, you'd expect. And it's actually pretty. The properties of this machine is actually interesting because it's very light, and it has a big sail surface. So if you look at it from the side, if you look at it from the bottom, it's like the footprint is very small, and it's like an ocean blimp. So very light, very quick to produce, very cheap. And so after this, I knew that the technology, or I thought that we had all these physics that we could explore, but that's quite difficult. How do you prove you have more control? How do you prove you can sail up the wind? How can you prove that you create lateral lift? So, you know, an airplane wing is moving like this, and that creates vertical lift. But if you put the wing like this, what would happen? We could actually sail closer to the wind, or completely new properties for sailing. And so I decided to put the project on Kickstarter, like a bet, and 300 people decided to crowdfund it, and then with this money, we recruited a team of engineers and designers, and we're working open hardware. Open hardware means that everything that we design is free to use, modify, and distribute. And the only two things that we require from people of the community or people from outside industry is to credit us somewhere, put the name, and just to share back with the community. Whatever they build on top of our code or on our mechanics or physics, they have to share back with the community. And what happens is that the schematics is that, you know, people are trying to sell things to each other and maximize the margin at each step of innovation. But in our case, we're actually working in parallel because everybody has an interest that the technology develops fast. So with this in mind, we build a bigger prototype. So this is the 3-meter-1 prototype in Rotterdam we built this summer. So I don't have so much time, so I won't show you the whole thing. But basically, the whole boat curves in the waves because it's following also the shape of waves. So you don't have all these knock hards on the hull. So it's very flexible robot. And our vision is to have this machine applied for different application. So the oil spill is a serious global problem, and it's not just one time in the US, it's like everywhere. So this is in the Gulf of Delta of Niger. We need an open-hearted technology because they could never afford the boats that we have here. This is in China, this is just 2 months ago in New Zealand, this is 2.5 weeks ago in Brazil, and this is in Japan. So I'm half Japanese, and my family lives in Niigata, which is just 150 kilometers away from Fukushima. So I just cycled from Tokyo to Sendai, and I was measuring the radioactivity and studying the effect of tsunami, and I just cycled like hundreds of kilometers of destroyed city. Imagine San Diego transformed into rolls of steel and wood, and maybe your children are inside it. I mean, it's incredible. But the worst is still happening is that the nuclear radiation are going to the ocean. And currently, we have really good data about land, but we don't have so much about the ocean. And the data produced in the ocean is produced by TEPCO or the Japanese government. And it's the same as the oil spill. We can't rely on this information. Citizens, people living, residents, they're making measurements which are twice as high as government-provided information. This is in the Pacific, you know the problem of plastic, so we need as well to have remote sensing devices to sense the plastic. And this is really the bottom line. So at the beginning I was saying we have this major environmental problem, and we think we have the world in our grasp. In fact, we have. So how are we going to address these big issues? This is business as usual. Like a company is organized to make profit using technology and human resources. And nature is usually, you know, it's green, so they can sell it to you more expensive. What if we flip this model bottom up, if we flip upside down, because the reality of the world is that if we don't have a natural system, we don't have a human system, we don't have technology, and money is a form of technology. So this is the way we're trying to approach engineering, making soft engineering, open hardware, and community development. And so I believe like if we don't make this choice to develop technology, I think it's the only meaningful way to develop technology if we want to foresee a future for nature and for ourselves in turn. Thank you very much.